The great I am promises to meet with us as we gather, and we're going to sing, Who Am I? That the Lord of all the earth would care to know my name. Huh? It's amazing, right? Who am I? Please stand.
That the Lord of all the earth would care to know my name, would care to feel my hurt. Who am I that the bright and morning star would choose to light the way for my ever wandering heart? Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, vapor in the wind. Still you Lord, you catch me when I'm falling, and you've told me who I am. I am yours. I am yours.
that see my sin would look on me with love and watch me rise again. Who am I that the voice that calmed the sea would call out through the rain and calm the storm in me? Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling. Lord, you catch me when I'm but because of what you've done, not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean,
seated.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Our call to worship this morning is Psalm 40, verses 1 through 3, and that begins on page 507 of the Bible. I waited patiently for the Lord, and he inclined to me and heard my cry. He brought me up out of the pit of destruction, out of the miry clay, and he set my feet upon a rock, making my footsteps firm. He put a new song in my mouth, a song of praise to our God. Many will see and fear and will trust in the Lord. As I was thinking about this scripture this morning, what comes to my mind is we all recognize that our world, and certainly parts of our world, seem like they're in the pit of destruction and stuck in miry clay. But all of us individually, at times, have been in our own pit of destruction or despair with our feet in miry clay. And I'm comforted in my trust in the Lord and the words of David, that I know even David had to wait patiently and wait for your perfect time, and the perfect time to set his feet upon a rock and making his footsteps firm. And that rock is our faith in you, Heavenly Father. So we thank you for this scripture as our call to worship today. In Jesus' name we pray.
Thank you for that thought, Bill. Even David, Moses, Abraham, everyone that we read about in the Bible had to wait for God, as we do this morning. Amen. Welcome to God's house this hour, this day, a beautiful day that he has made for the church picnic. So we have that happening. But before we get to those details, please turn off your cell phones if you haven't done so already, or put them on matter mode. Special welcome to Linda, Edie Perfetti's niece from the great state of Texas. And anyway, she's the caretaker for this week. So God bless you, Linda. Great to see you again. Janice, welcome this morning. Great to see you. So anyway, I had mentioned about the church picnic today, and it's at the Ganaway residence, 62 Pleasant Street in Rainham. Praise God for GPS if you don't know where it is. It won't take you to Death Valley this morning, I promise you that. It may take you to Town Hall, but not Death Valley, okay? So let me see. To the Ganaway residence as soon as you can after church. I understand all the condiments have been provided, and burgers, hot dogs, rolls. You're supposed to, you were encouraged to bring a side dish, but I said to you last week, if you didn't get a chance to make anything, you weren't in a position to, you know, we have more than enough food, trust me. I don't know where it comes from, but we have more than enough food. And your presence is more important than you bringing food. Amen? Jane. That's awesome.
I ordered 5 extra, just in case you change your mind. You know where you can find me. Okay?
So yeah, so, okay, so if you were not here last week, this is a reading program that Jane has kind of encouraged, but it's A Shepherd Looks at Psalm 23. It's a fantastic read, absolutely awesome book, and it dissects Psalm 23 from a shepherd's perspective. Folks, you won't believe what a shepherd has to do, all right? And but your soul will be enriched, and I would encourage you to that if you have not read that book, okay? Let me see. So what else? We're supposed to have the sanctuary project again start tomorrow. We hope and pray that that works out. It looks like it's going to be done in piecemeal as we move along here. Anything else this morning for the good of the congregation? Anything else? Okay, so we hope to see you at the picnic, and Bob, you're going to come and lead us in our next song.
Turn right, and there's 4,000 on the left. It's a yellow house.
You just moved there, right?
Yeah. 40-some-odd years ago. All right, please turn over to number 224. We have come into your house. And Lord, please stand number 224. We have come into your house and gathered in his name to worship him. We have come into his house and gathered in his name to worship him. We have come into his house and gathered in his name and worship.
Christ the Lord, worship Him, Jesus Christ the Lord.
You may be seated.
Offertory verse this morning is from the book of Proverbs, chapter 10. Excuse me, chapter 11, verse 18. The wicked earns deceptive wages, but he who sows righteousness gets a true reward. Father, we thank you that we can sow into your kingdom today and know that it will bless this church, this ministry, and all who are here. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Dave and Bob, come forward.
Please stand for the doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son,
may be seated.
This morning, I'd like to have a season of prayer rather than me just have a pastoral prayer. And I want to remind you, pray for Mickey Tilson, Rose Mulqueeney, Fred Legler, the Johnson family, Mim Dal, to name a few. So pray as you feel led, and then also that God would bless our time together at the picnic. So pray as you feel led, and I'll close our time.
Mm-hmm. Lord, we just pray that you would be with each one who is here today, and be especially with those who could not be here today but wanted to be here with us. Father, we pray your continued blessing upon them for health and for strength and for comfort, and just that each one would feel your presence. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Amen.
Dear Father, we thank you for your mercies and your love. We bring the nations of the world to you, God. Lord, the Bible says, God, that all nations will praise you. It's our heart desire, God, that the nations of the world will praise you. Every living soul, God, that exist on this earth this day. We learn how to appreciate you for everything that you have given to man to survive on. And Lord, we pray that your righteousness, Lord, will reign in the nations, O God, that the leaders of the world will come to regard you as God, and we submit to your will, O God. And Lord, we pray for everyone that believes in the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus all over the globe, that in this hard time, O God, that you will be gracious to protect us from all evil, that you will be gracious, O Lord, to heal the sick among us, O Lord, that your church, O Lord, will return back to your ways, O God, your church will embrace your truth, O Lord, and live according to your purpose, even until our Lord Jesus return for us. Lord, we say thank you. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. Anybody else?
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this glorious day. We thank you for all that have come out this morning to worship you and to have fellowship. We pray for our fellowship this afternoon at the Ganaways, and we pray that all goes well and the weather is good, and you're in charge of that, dear Lord. Pray also for all those on our prayer chain, Mickey and Rose, Marie, Edie, and whoever else. Please give them healing and strength and peace. And I thank you for all of them also. And I thank you mostly for Jesus and all that he did for us on that cross. And I pray through him. In his name, amen.
Amen. Heavenly Father, thank you for the reminder this morning that David waited patiently for you. And we do as well this morning for you to answer prayers, give us enlightenment and wisdom in various situations and circumstances in life that we're currently dealing with, that we're praying about, family situations, relationships, situations that we read about in the world, or even with our current shut-ins,
and those who need a healing or great encouragement of heart. We wait patiently for you to answer prayer, and especially to change us. We all need a fresh revelation of you, O God. We all need to be changed. I know we're being transformed from glory to glory, and yet, Lord, sometimes we just don't see it fast enough or enough. May we wait patiently upon you. May we be ever mindful that in our weakness you're made strong. And we bless you for that. And thank you for the reminder to pray for our missionaries this morning as Esther prayed. And we pray that your light, your truth, your gospel would find its way into the remotest places of the earth and the remotest hearts that we could ever imagine. Thank you that you do the miraculous. You save the sinner. You save the unlovable. You save the one that's not good. No, there's no one that is good. We bless you for being gracious and slow to anger, abounding in loving kindness. And may we find great encouragement and great hope this morning in that truth and in our worship time together and in our fellowship time together. And we pray in Jesus' name, amen. Okay, we have a scripture reading, Dave.
Both scripture readings this morning are from the book of Job. The first one, the 29th chapter of Job, verses 21 through 25, and that's on page 475 in the Church Bible. Again, the 29th chapter of Job, verses 21 through 25, and again on page 475. To me, they listened and waited and kept silent for my counsel. After my words, they did not speak again, and my speech dropped on them. They waited for me as for the rain and opened their mouth as for the spring rain. I smiled on them when they did not believe, and the light of my face they did not cast down. I chose a way for them and sat as chief and dwelt as a king among the troops, as one who comforted the mourners. May the Lord add his blessing to the reading of his word.
Amen. Thanks, Dave. Our next song, Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone. Please stand.
My heart to feel, and grace my my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope secures. He will my shield and portion me as long as life endures. My chains are
Our second reading this morning, also from the book of Job, the fourth chapter, verses 1 through 6, and that's found on page 458 of the Bible. Then Eliphaz the Temanite answered, "If one ventures a word with you, will you become impatient? But who can refrain from speaking? Behold, you have admonished many, and you have strengthened weak hands. Your words have helped the tottering to stand, and you have strengthened feeble knees. But now it has come to you, and you are impatient. It touches you, and you are dismayed. Is not your fear of God your confidence, and the integrity of your ways your hope?" This too is the word of our Lord.
Good
Let's have a word of prayer. Father, take these scriptures and this time and use it to your honor and to your glory, and speak to each heart that's here and to each heart that would ever listen to this message. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So, folks, I want you to visualize this. If I had chocolate on my hands right up to my elbows, now I'm not talking about a few chocolate bars that I've played with, okay? I'm talking about taking my arms and dipping it right into a big kettle of chocolate, okay? And I came in here like that this morning, and I shook Chuck's hand and Jerry Hartgrove's hand, and I gave Linda Redman a big hug, and I slapped other people on the back, and then you folks run around and you start touching other people, right? It would be a whole lot of chocolate mess, right? Now, you may be licking your fingers a little bit, but you would also be looking for wet wipes, too, at the end of the day. I would suggest to you that that's kind of like what happens in Christian fellowship. Sometimes it's a little messy, but it's sweet. And that's what I hope to communicate this morning, is the sweetness of Christian fellowship. And if only all of us could see and capture what God wants to do in the circles of Christian friendship and fellowship, we'd all be less sensitive to what was said and done or what wasn't said and done. And we'd all be better persons and Christians for it. Amen? We'd all say, give me that sweet, sweet Christian fellowship. Now, you've heard the expression, what goes around comes around. That's the title of the sermon this morning, primarily because I couldn't really think of how else to express it. But when we hear that expression, it's communicating a principle. Often we associate it, or at least I do, with bad stuff. But it also applies with good stuff like chocolate, you know, or Christian fellowship, or righteousness, or holiness, or peace, or God's wisdom of Christ and His Spirit touching His people in fellowship, of Christian gifts being shared where I'm blessed and you're blessed and everyone else is blessed that's sitting next to you, of Christian gifts multiplying blessings to others in community. Now, I was led to choose verses out of the book of Job, and this is one of these books that we rarely ever go into with a Bible study. We might get into it when we read, like, our daily bread. They might have, like, a little devotional thought. But most of the time, we're not in the book of Job because it's 42 chapters. And it's a lot of bantering and going back and forth and talking about philosophical issues in life and why, Job, you're wrong. And Job saying, well, no, it's not, I'm not wrong and I'm not a sinner and I didn't do anything wrong. And so there's this whole going back. And we don't typically go into the book. But there it is full of a treasure trove of sharing one's thoughts and perspectives and their spiritual journey. And it's huge. Now, you probably know that Job was a giant in the community. He was a giant in his environment. His influence in the land was second to none. He lived in the patriarchal times, perhaps before Abraham's time, maybe a little bit after Abraham's time. But he was a giant in the faith, a giant in the community. And he had a tremendous impact on people. Now, I want you to go over to Job 29, if you have your Bibles open, because I want to show you some portions of Scripture that Dave did not read this morning, primarily because we don't have time, and besides, it's great to take you to it myself here. But If you have a superscription in your Bible, it talks about Job's past was glorious. That is 7 days before he ever had trials come upon his life. I mean, he was the man. You know, he had tremendous standing in community, and he did tremendous things for people. Here you go. He spiritually invested like none other. Verses 8 through 11, it talks about when he walked down the street, nobles and princes and everyone who was, they would pause, they would hush. They saw a great man in their midst. And then verse 12, it talks about how he helped the poor. And verse 13, how he helped the widow. And verses 15 and 16, how he helped the disadvantaged. And verse 23, how he spiritually watered other people. And verse 25, how he comforted people. And when you go back to Job chapter 4, Eliphaz, his friend, talks about how he admonished or counseled a lot of people, and how he strengthened many, and how his words were a blessing and were effective. Brothers and sisters, that's a great person. That's a godly person. That's a person who is transformational when they move in and around about people and in any environment. And I would submit to you that that's what happens in the body of Christ. You take the godly people in the church, the body of Christ, and it transfers. It's transformational. Now, everyone is not a Job, but everyone contributes as such to the body of Christ. No, everyone can't do it all. But every single one of us has done this in some form or fashion. Amen? If you've been in the church, you've done it. Sharing, encouraging, helping, strengthening, building one another up. Not tearing people down. Admonishing, watering, comforting, helping the disadvantaged. That's the church. That's what happens within the body of Christ. Now, what I don't want to do this morning is I don't want to ignore the context. Because if you've been in the church any length of time, you know the context. Most of us know the story of Job. So when one day he loses his wealth, he loses some servants, he loses his children, and he loses his health. I mean, the Bible indicates that his friends, as they were going to visit him, he was so bad from a distance they couldn't even recognize who Job was. Now, that's pretty bad. And so what we understand here is that even Job had a breaking point. Amen? Everyone has a breaking point. And now he has to work through these issues. The very things that he helped people with in the past, he's got to deal with now. And so we understand that no one is exempt from trouble, right? I mean, you can be sailing along at 70, 80 miles an hour in life, and all of a sudden, metaphorically speaking, the tire blows out. And it just happens just like that. I was talking to a guy last week, an appliance repair guy, and he said, "Oh my goodness, you know, it all happened in 1 year within a very, very short time. Everything went south." It's like Job, right? And so, you know the story. His friends come along. They sit with him for 7 days. They mourn with him. They cry with him. I have to tell you, folks, I've never had somebody come and sit with me for 7 days during hardship and hard times. Harold Perry was there just about every single day for me when I needed him to take me to doctors, as you folks have been with some other people in the church. But these are true loving friends. They come and they sit for 7 days. They forget about their family and their occupation, and all they care about is comforting Job. And you know that they meant well, but they fell short, right? You know the approach. Their approach was less than stellar. They shared their experience in God. They shared their wisdom, even though they were slightly off the mark. And here's the point. God used all that to bring some things out in Job's life and heart that he never saw. If this didn't happen, Job would have never have seen it. And so what he does here, he uses this whole situation to elevate Job, to elevate his three friends. God corrected Job's friends, and in the end, they were better people. In the end, Job was a better person for it, because God corrected him too. But not without the hurt and the pain and the scars and all the stuff that goes with it. And so as I look at this, as we read this together, these things are for our learning, right? And each of us has a very, very limited view of what God is doing in our own lives, let alone the lives and hearts of other saints, right? And yet, what does the Apostle Paul say in Philippians chapter 1, verse 6? He says, "For I am confident of this very thing, that he who began in work in you will complete it till the day, or will perfect it until the day of Christ Jesus." Whatever God is doing, he's doing it to perfection until the day of Christ Jesus. Amen? That's what he's doing. And then we also read Romans 8:28. Now we know that God causes all things to work together for good. Despite wrong perspectives when shared, despite wrong words when thoughtfully or carelessly uttered, or even wrong interpretations of things and people and events. We were studying Ezekiel last week, chapter 11, and all the people in Jerusalem, you know what they were saying? Oh, we're the remnant. We're the remnant, and they're patting themselves on the back. And God said, no, you're not the remnant. The remnant are the people who are in exile. They had a totally wrong perspective. You know, sometimes we have wrong perspectives, don't we? We might prejudge a person. We might have an attitude and say, oh, this situation or that person. And we don't even know the half of it, do we? And yet, what he does is he still works through weakness to produce the sweetness of Christ in Christian fellowship. None of us sees it all or knows it all, as they say, but these things belong to God and to God alone. And so we have this great Saint Job, a great man, great reputation, used mightily of God, and he hit some major speed bumps in life, and now the wheels start to wobble. Ever been there? I have. And so what God does, God says, I think Job needs a realignment. I think he needs some work done on his wheels. And he comes in and he brings a change in attitude, a change of heart, and he works in very, very difficult circumstances and situations. Thank God that he deals with our attitudes, amen? Because I know that my attitude is not always where it should be, and I know what yours isn't either. Why do I know that? Because you're human. Even David had to wait patiently, right? And so I would suggest to you that often this is where spiritual transformation and transference takes place. You know, transference is this term that they use in psychology, where things transfer from one person to another. But, you know, this is where it happens when you hit the speed bump, when you run into difficult times, then you need somebody else to come alongside and to help us in that situation. Yeah, God's always there, but you need the human touch, and God uses it quite often, does he not? And so I would say to you, this is where we need Christian people and Christian fellowship the most. I want somebody to encourage me and to talk to me and to be there, maybe just to even sit silently. I'm okay with that. And when we're not in the assembly of believers, we miss all that. I want their encouragement. I want their perspectives. I want their righteousness. I want their wisdom. I want their holiness. I want their redemptive stories. I want to hear about their spiritual journey. What has God laid upon their heart? What has God said to them in difficult times? I want to know that. I want to hear it. I want to feel it and be touched by that. And you know, I understand as I read this passage, this didn't happen in a church setting. Probably happened on Job's property, somewhere outside his house. But it did happen in the context of other believers, and it did happen in community, even though it wasn't a formal church setting. And it's in these moments where you have this spiritual transference. Hope is transferred, comfort received, encouragement shared, strength recaptured, vision reacquired. And I'm well aware, because I've taught this book before in Bible school. I've had to, when I taught Bible school, and I also had to study this in Bible school and seminary. And I'm well aware that these friends came along, and they did say some improper things, and they said some things in an untimely manner, and maybe in an insensitive manner. And maybe it was not always in the right spirit, but I do believe that it was certainly with the right motive and right intent. And God used it all. And this is not an argument for talking about, you know, saying improper things and et cetera, et cetera. But it's to realize that God uses it all. You've heard the story. How's a pearl shaped? A lot of sanding, grinding, right? And you get this beautiful pearl. And by the way, you know, we read this story and we say, well, Job's friends, you know, they weren't very kind or nice to him. Actually, if you read the story, Job pushed back against some of the things that they said to him. And some of the things they said to him were not all untrue. Job pushed back because he wasn't that receptive and gracious. And they in turn pushed back. But that's how you get the pearl, you see? And that's transference at its core. It's give and take and exchange, and it's getting perspective. This past week, our washing machine died. Jerry is in mourning. It was a KitchenAid. And the guy said, you could buy a Whirlpool for $500-$600. It would cost me at least $500 to fix it. So we're researching washing machines, right? It's amazing what you learn about when you research washing machines or anything, right? So you have this option between impeller-driven or agitator. Was anybody aware of that? Impeller or agitator. By the way, Whirlpool came out with the 2-in-1. That's the very first model, okay? Just pop the agitator out, and now you got an impeller. This is what my research revealed. It's the agitator that supposedly cleans the clothing better by rubbing the clothing back and forth against one another. Now, the impeller's supposed to be a little bit more gentle of a wash, but it doesn't do as well, they say. Now, both approaches do a good job, but one is supposed to be better. You know, I was thinking, how else does God pull things out of us without a little agitation? How else do we see our sin and our shortcomings? Because as I understand it, I got this big log in my eye, and I can't see a blessed thing half the time. The cataracts are forming, I think, too. Before this trial in Job's life, He just transformed people, transfers to other people, and now he needs it himself. And that's what happens when saints gather in sweet fellowship. It's like spreading chocolate. People change. A little messy. The environment changes too. In the end, Job's friends learn to be less judgmental and less critical. That's a blessed thing. They walked away with a more positive and less condemning experience. They were more gracious and understanding because God gave them more understanding and more grace. And let's not overlook Job, by the way, because he benefited from all this too. If you read in the end, the scripture says he was doubly blessed. Isn't that amazing how God does that? You and I have been around a lot of people. Maybe we found ourselves in a lot of different environments where it's been positive and negative, or sweet and sour, or one that's been full of grace or full of anger. And what happens is, if we don't handle that situation rightly, stuff transfers, doesn't it? Maybe we get angry. We take that anger that somebody else is sharing and we appropriate it. Or that grace. And here's the point that I want to make. It's how we deal with such situations that speaks to how we are as people and how we grow as people in Christ. Because despite the missteps of Job's friends, I read this here. I don't see Job holding such things that were said about him to their account. I don't see him getting, he got a little impatient and flustered, but I don't see him, in the end, being totally dismissive of their relationships and their friendships. You know, a lot of times what we do is we dismiss people. Done, one and done. That's what we do. Thank God that God comes back for more, amen? Thank God he doesn't dismiss us after one and done. By the way, neither did Jesus be dismissive. You know what he said when he was hanging on the cross? Anybody? Father, forgive them, for they know not what they're doing. And as I understand it, Job moved on from this situation, his friends moved on, but they didn't move on from the friendship, the relationship. They were Christ to one another. That's how I see it. Remember, transference and transformation goes both ways. As I said, what goes around comes around. We sow to the flesh, we reap the flesh. We sow to the Spirit, we reap the Spirit. And 1 Corinthians 15, verse 33 touches on this. Bad company corrupts good morals, the scripture says. We hang around with bad people. Bad stuff is going to happen. It's a transference. Conversely, we hang around with good people, godly people, transference happens. Good stuff happens. The church is not a perfect environment, amen? Because we're all sinners. We're redeemed, but we're sinners. But I would submit to you that it's a better environment than most. And I'm assuming that Christ is in the fellowship and that he's preached. And we're in God's echo chamber and we hear truth. We share in community. We learn together. We live together. We love together. We walk with God together. We share hardships and trials. We share in difficulty. When one hurts, we all hurt. We share our sour lemons in life with one another. How is it going? Not too good. And we also share the lemonade that we've made from the sour lemons with one another, do we not? I think there will be lemonade at the party, at the picnic this afternoon, probably. And so the way I understand it is we learn from one another, we grow from one another in Christ. That's a precious thing. And yet, how many people just divorce themselves or remove themselves from a fellowship because they had a little tiff with somebody. They didn't like what the pastor said. They didn't like what was done on a board or a committee. Or, you know, they think that the leadership is wrong and they just split the church. It's so depressing and sad. You know, 1 Corinthians 3, Paul said that one plants, one waters, and God gives the increase. That happens in salvation, especially in the sanctification process. If you don't put yourself within Christian influence and friendship, then you lose, I lose, that watering and the growth part. It's all here on the pages of Scripture. Earlier in the week, I was talking with somebody about how iron sharpens iron. Now, you think about that friction. It sounds pretty gruesome, but it's a very, very sweet thing. Because I love it when somebody sharpens my perspective. I love it when somebody else makes me a little bit more smarter and I have greater insight and perspective on things. Isn't that a wonderful thing? Iron sharpens iron. I can't begin to tell you. I've been here, how long, Helen? Where is Helen? 30, and some people would still say too long. I love the fact that Bob Gannaway sharpens me. I love the fact that Jane raises questions in Bible study. I love the fact that Drew at times, hello, you know, the whole idea of being challenged and talking and sharing about what a scripture means and what God is doing in your life and your heart. I love it. It's wonderful, is it not? But in this conversation with this person, we were talking about how you take certain things and maybe you leave certain things. You ever notice that? You take certain things, you leave certain things. Why is it that we leave certain things? I don't know. Maybe we don't have the capacity for it. Maybe we don't have the spirit for it at the time. But for whatever reason, we can't relate and we don't take certain things. You read the Gospels. That happened all the time with Christ and the disciples, did it not? How many times did he share something and they didn't take it? They didn't even take some of it. They were totally clueless to it. It happened a lot. And you know what God did? He said it again. And he did it again. And he did it. And after a while, each disciple was changed over time, in community, with one another, with Christ right at the center. You read the Gospels, the disciples were different in the end than in the beginning, were they not? I want that difference. So in closing, I would say to you that Christian fellowship produces a sweet spiritual transformation, and it's like spreading chocolate, little here, little there, until everyone is touched and covered, except it's not chocolate. It's the Lord Jesus Christ. It doesn't get any sweeter than that. I would not trade him or the church or this process for the entire world, because I want to be a better person, and I know that God wants me to be a better person, and I know that you want to be a better person, and I know that God wants you to be a better person. Amen. And so that is the sweetness of Christian fellowship, and that is what God has laid upon my heart today. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I think of the scripture that says you give us richly all things to enjoy, whether it's chocolate or Christian fellowship. We bless you for all the things
the good things in life that you send our way. Tremendous friends, Christian friendship, a wonderful church, the blessings of Christ in community and in fellowship. And thank you for those difficult times where you create the pearl in difficult relationships and in trying situations. We can't bless you enough for the trials that you send our way. We're encouraged to rejoice in those trials because we know that you're producing Christ in us, the hope of glory. And we bless you for that. I thank you for each heart that's here. I thank you for the church of the living God. Thank you, Lord, that you're building your church and the gates of hell will never prevail against it. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Uh, 429, folks, is our closing song. 429, they'll know we are Christians. Please stand. God bless you richly until we meet again. We hope to see you at the picnic. Bob, would you close us in prayer? And would you ask the blessing on the food, too?
Absolutely.
Awesome.
Our dear precious Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for the messages you gave us this morning. Lord, that we would be like Job and become more like you as we go from day to day. And Lord, we just ask you would be with us as we have the picnic this afternoon. That we just thank you for the food that will be provided and for all the good things that you do this afternoon. We'll put you first and foremost in all that we do. And we ask these things in our name.
Amen. Amen. Have a good day.
See you at the picnic?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
Just one.
Yeah.
Okay. So I just wanted to give you a heads up.